You ever been sailing?
Yes.
Imagine yourself looking out at the vast sea before you. You reach down and you put a hand into the water and you scoop it up towards you. Immediately the water starts leaking through your fingers until the hand is empty. That water is a man's life. From birth to death, it is always slipping through our hands until it is gone. Along with all that you hold dear in this world. And yet the kingdom I speak of, that I live for, is like the rest of the water out in the sea. Man lives for that cup of water that slips through his fingers. But those that follow Jesus Christ live for that endless expanse of sea.
That particular segment is so powerful that, and it's so true that you and I oftentimes live for what we can hold in our hands and not for the expanse of what God has for us. And so today we're going to continue in our series Choose. And for me to live in the kingdom of God, I've got to make a daily choice. I have to make a choice to live in that kingdom. And my prayer for you is that you'll see that you'll really grab a hold of the concept that there is a daily choice to be made of whose kingdom am I really living in? Whose kingdom am I building, and whose kingdom really drives my life? So let's stop and pray, and let's just ask the Lord to really work in our lives. Father, I just want to thank you for what you're going to do today in advance. And I pray, God, in the name of Jesus, God, that your spirit will lead and guide my words in such a way that your people will be able to hear and receive with thanksgiving what you have for them. And I pray these things in the beloved name of our Savior. Amen. So I'm going to tell you once again that we're going to stretch you a little bit here today. And some of you are going to be stretched more than others. And we're going to talk about some very, very important kingdom matters as they relate to you and how you live your daily life. And so I trust and pray that you will listen with an open mind, and I trust that you'll do that. That you'll engage with God, because what you want is so much more than you have. And I'm going to show you how to live in a different way, how to have a better life than what you have. So with that in mind, I want to remind you why we're doing this series. It's called Choose, and it's based around what we have discovered in the gospel. So I want to ask you this question again. If you only had Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, what would you conclude as to the primary message that Jesus taught? What was the gospel according to Jesus? And so let me show it to you. Let me show you the gospel according to Jesus. And you can see it all the way through the New Testament. It's not bits and pieces. It's all the way through the New Testament. In fact, almost every parable story that Jesus talked about, he talked about this particular subject matter. So let me show it to you. It's found in the Gospel of Matthew. Let me set the historical context for you. Jesus has been baptized. He is then taken into the wilderness to face the temptations of the evil one. He has passed the test, and now he comes back and starts his public ministry. And the very first public speaking engagement, Jesus announces his purpose. So let me show you this. In Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, this is what he says. Matthew 4, 17, from that time, Jesus began to preach, saying, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Jesus came to offer the kingdom, which included things that you and I love dearly, things like eternal life, things like forgiveness, things like all those things are inclusive in this message. But the primary message, according to Jesus, was this thing called the kingdom of God. And God offers it to you right now, here and now. You and I can possess the kingdom this moment. You and I can have that kingdom. Jesus says the kingdom is at hand. So you have to choose which kingdom you're going to live for. The message is simply this. If you repent right now, you can be transferred from the kingdom of earth to the kingdom of God. It requires repentance. So what does that word mean? That word literally means, so for you and I To repent means to change our mind, and it is a concept that acknowledges and probably infers more than anything that it is an unconditional surrender to God. And this is a very powerful thing. Here's what you need to know about that. If you repent and turn to Jesus and you enter this kingdom, from that day forward, your life is going to be in direct opposition to the kingdoms of this world. And therefore, you're going to have a lot of conflict. This isn't a message that, oh, I'm going to have this peaceful, amazing life. You're going to have an amazing life. But the truth is that there's going to be a lot of conflict, because when Jesus proclaimed this message, they took him and nailed him to the cross. Because he began to change how people think, and he began to confront the kingdoms of this earth. And this was, you can see it all through his teaching. In fact, I suggest this year sometime you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and you see if what I'm not saying is true. And if I'm wrong, I'll publicly apologize to y'all. But the truth is that I've spent 4 months in, you know, just in my backyard when I was ill, just pouring through scripture again, saying, God, what do you want me to see? And this is what he showed me. He showed me about the kingdom of God, not about religion. It's about a kingdom that he offers to you right now. And the entrance to this kingdom is very simple. It requires everything you got. It's unconditional surrender. It's not negotiation. It's unconditional surrender to the living God, Jesus the Messiah. And you and I are great negotiators when it comes to God. So I'll just tell you this quick story. I have been getting a lot of email, and I've been getting some communication back. And people are saying to me, Pastor Dan, there's a lot more ways that I can express my unconditional surrender to God rather than giving. And my answer back is simply always the same. You're still negotiating with God. Stop negotiating. You're still trying to find the loophole. Instead of going to God and saying, I'm just going to unconditionally surrender to the living God. That is what God requires to enter this kingdom. And it's a very powerful thing. And then, once we understand that Jesus' message is the kingdom of God, then you just begin to see the Gospels in a different light. And all the stories and all the parables that he teaches all relate to this. And almost all of them have to do with how we handle our money. Money becomes the barometer of whether or not I believe that or not. It is. It's the barometer. So let me show you one passage of scripture that is just stands out, but there are hundreds that I could show you, honestly. Let me show you just one. This is what it says. Luke 16:11 says, and if you are untrustworthy about worldly wealth, who will trust you with the true riches of heaven? Jesus says it this way, if I can't trust you with what I place in your hand, how in the world am I going to trust you with what I want to place in your heart? So the truth is that money then becomes how I handle it, how I use it, how I save it, how I give it, everything about it, how I spend it, all then becomes a test from God to determine whether or not God is going to be able to create for me a new way of living and create this trust in my life where he can really give me what he wants to give me. Now, here's the problem with our culture. You and I have an addiction. And I'm going to tell you, almost everyone I talk to has this particular addiction. And here's what it is. The addiction is that you and I, by evidence of the fact that we continually want to buy more stuff, we have this consumer debt that's unbelievable. And you and I are addicted to buying stuff. We like to. We like to buy stuff, right? We like to go shopping. I'm not talking about grocery shopping here. I'm talking about shopping for toys and things and pretty things and all that kind of stuff. We like to shop. And so it becomes a problem for us in terms of how God has placed certain things in our hand. So how do I know that you and I are addicted to spending? So let me show you to you why I believe that. The issue is that you and I believe a lie. And that lie is simply this. The lie is freedom is determined by possessions and wealth. You and I believe the lie that if we have more, we have more freedom and we have more happiness. And if we have less, we certainly couldn't be happy and be poor, right? So the truth is the more we possess, the more encumbered we'll be. So does our culture have a problem with what I just explained. And I'm going to say, I believe they do. So I'm going to ask you a series of questions. What do you think credit card debt is in total for the United States of America? What do you think the total number of credit card debt is? You're right, actually, almost. It's $1.0 trillion. That doesn't include cars. I'm taking out, you know, some kinds of debt. Doesn't include cars and other things. This is just the plastic. Plastic in America has become an idol. We just learned to live beyond our means with this thing called plastic. So what do you think? Now, here's another question. What do you think the average, this is the latest statistics, 2018. What do you suppose the average household credit card debt is in America? 7,000? You're almost there? Well, let me show it to you. $16,000. The average household is indebted at the rate of $16,000. That means the average household has bought $16,000 more than they can actually afford. And I want to say to you, we're going to look at some scripture today. I want to say to you that that is a problem for those that are entering the kingdom. That's a problem for us because of a variety of reasons, and we'll talk about those in just a few minutes. But, you know, in our world today that you and I live, we live with three kinds of people. There are three kinds of people in our world. There's the haves, the have-nots, and the have-not paid for what they have. That's the three classes of people. So why is this such a big deal? So why am I taking a whole service and why am I talking about debt and, you know, isn't that kind of unspiritual and unscriptural? And I want to say to you, absolutely the opposite. Let me show you why I'm teaching what I'm teaching here today. The book of Proverbs, chapter 22, verse 17 says, "The rich rule over the poor and the borrower is the slave to the lender." So when you have this major amount of credit card debt in your life, you are a servant, not just to Jesus, but you're a servant to who you borrowed that money from. And if you don't think that's not the truth, then here's what I'd encourage you to do. Just stop paying the credit card bill and see what happens to you. You are a servant. When you have credit card debt and you are paying interest on that credit card debt, listen to me carefully, you are living outside of the boundaries of God's will for your life. You're living outside of those boundaries. And you're presuming upon the future, and you're committing an act of idolatry in your life. Ooh, did he say that? I did. And let me tell you what I mean by that. You have another master besides Jesus. And that master controls your happiness. And I'm going to say to you that if you don't get that, there, you know, I'm saying, listen to me. If you don't get that, there's a major problem. You cannot live beyond your means. It's outside of the boundaries of how people who follow Jesus are commanded to walk. Jesus gives us a new way of living. So let me show it to you. Just in case you're wondering, you're thinking, well, you're just making this stuff up, Pastor Dan. So let me show it to you. It's found in the Gospel of Matthew. We're going to be in Matthew 6 for a little bit. So if you brought your Bibles, you can turn there. But here's what it says. Jesus, these are words of Jesus. But don't worry about your life. Don't worry about your life. What you'll eat or drink, or about your body, what you'll wear. Is not life more important than food and the body more important than clothes? Oh, you of little faith. So do not worry saying, what shall we eat or what shall we drink or what shall we wear? And then this is the verse that I want you to hone in on. Get this. This is it. This is what Jesus says. He says, then Jesus says, for the pagans, those are people that are outside the faith who are living in idolatrous relationships with other gods. For the pagans run after all these things and your heavenly Father knows that you have need of them. Jesus is saying here, I have a better life for you. Don't act like people who are living in idolatry. Act like people who know Jesus, who know a Father in heaven who loves to provide. Are you with me so far? We having fun yet? Awesome. Because it's going to get worse. Here we go. Then Jesus gives us not just a suggestion, but he gives us a different approach. And this is in a command form. So this isn't you ought to think about this. This is how I want you as a believer to live. He says this, this is how kingdom people live, because Matthew chapter 6 is kingdom principles. So in Matthew chapter 6, Jesus says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. All these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. So Jesus is saying here, what I want from your life, this is the word, this is Jesus's word for you today. This is what you need to know. This is what Jesus wants to say to you. Your command from God is to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and not worry about those purchases. It's not that God doesn't want us to have nice things. He provides nice things. It's that when I go outside of God's boundary for my life, and I begin to purchase those nice things for myself, and I can't pay for them, like vacations and things, I'm telling you, you're violating a way that God has for you to live. And there is a price tag that is beyond your ability to even imagine of what it really costs you in the end. So let's talk about some consequences of this debt that we are incurring as a nation. $1.031 trillion, $16,000 per household. Let's talk about what that costs us in terms of emotionally first. Let's start there. Debt causes us to worry and stress. Debt has no ability to bring joy into your life. I'm going to come back to that in just a few minutes. Joy doesn't come from being in debt. In fact, debt is a serious enemy to mental health. Mental illness in our culture is rising as we speak because the stress levels in America are rising as we speak. There are other factors. I'm not saying that's the only factor. I'm saying it is a factor that when you and I live in a way that we're not designed to live by God, what happens is that we are living under a pressure that God doesn't want. It's too high of a price tag. It's too high of a price tag. Debt also, if you think about what debt does, debt causes us to live in a stupid way and actually causes us to lose a grip on reality at times. So I want to show you a video that kind of demonstrates what I'm saying. So watch this video. Yeah, I love that video. That's fun. That's funny. But it's so true. Because some of us in this room, I won't name names right now, have bought stuff when they don't have the money. And you get the danger of that. And not only that, not only does it create stress, and not only does it give us a sense of non-reality, it's also very addicting. When you start down that path, there is an addiction that happens, and psychologists will tell you about that. There's an addiction that happens when you begin the process of purchasing and you begin that debt road. There's something that happens in your brain that creates an addiction in your life. So it's a very dangerous thing for you and I to do. And according to research, I find this fascinating, I really do, is that they did a study and they found that people who had one income families, if they got two incomes in that family, in other words, husband, wife, work, that the debt doubled in number. Very fascinating thing. 98% of the time, debt is an internal problem, not an external factor. It is an internal issue. It is something inside of us. It isn't a matter of insufficient funds. It's a matter of insufficient self-control. That's what it is. Steve Martin says this. He says, I love money. I love everything about it. I bought some pretty good stuff. Got me a $300 pair of socks. Got a first sink, an electric dog polisher, a gasoline-powered turtleneck sweater, and of course I bought some dumb stuff too. It's an addiction. Mike Tyson, you remember him, the boxer? He ended up in 2003, I think, filing for bankruptcy. And here's the story that led up to that. The bottom line is for the last 9 previous years, he made $300 million. And in the 10th year, filed for bankruptcy. $300 million. Can't live within your means at $300 million. It's not a matter of how much money you have. It has to do with what's inside of you. And it is not how God has intended you to live. And I'm just going to say, it doesn't matter how old you are or how young you are, start now. Start now and live the way that God has designed you to live. It is a powerful thing. And debt deprives God of a chance to say no or provide through a better way. That's what debt does sometimes. Oftentimes we take it into our own hands, saying, I want this. And instead of praying about it and asking God to provide it, we just do it ourselves. We go out and we do it ourselves. And we buy it and we create for ourselves a really inappropriate issue in our lives, because that's a lack of trust. We're not trusting God to provide what he wants for our lives. God provides in unusual ways. You all have heard of the infamous Jesse James, right? Well, there's a story about him that I believe is true. I read this in a book, and of course, if it's in a book, it's true, right? At least it's more accurate than the internet, so let's just start there. But Jesse James allegedly had robbed a bank, and he was on the run, and he came to a farmhouse, and there was a widow that lived in the farmhouse. So he stopped in and asked if they could, you know, rest their horses and have a little refreshment. So this was a widow. She had almost nothing. So she apologized to Jesse James and her gang for not having enough food in the house. And she told Jesse James, excuse me, that the creditor was going to be there any minute, and that she owed $1,400 and there was no way that she could pay. So Jesse James said, I'll tell you what. Takes out his bag of money, gives her $1,400 and says, get a receipt. When he shows up, get a receipt. So Jesse and his gang went out in the bushes, watched the creditor come along, and she pays the $1,400, and he goes to leave, gets the receipt, goes to leave. Jesse jumps him, and takes his money back and rides off. So I'm saying all that. Whether that's true or not, I don't know. But here's what I do know. I do know that God provides in unusual ways when you and I learn to trust him. When you and I learn to trust God instead of taking things into our own hands. And I'm going to tell you honestly, we should be praying over many of the purchases that we make. My wife and I, as a couple, when we have a certain dollar figure, and the truth is that when we exceed that certain dollar figure, we go to God and we say, God, is this a good purchase for us? Is this what you want for us? And we listen for the voice of God. We listen for an answer. And if we don't get one, if we don't have peace about it, then we just simply don't buy it, because we're letting God have the opportunity to say no. And that's something that you and I do not like hearing, is those words, no, you can't have that, you spoiled brat. Smile at me. I know that some of you are in pain right now. Smile anyway. So the truth is that you and I live in a way that's contrary to the words of Jesus, right? I mean, most of us are living in a way that's contrary to the words of Jesus Christ. And it is going to be very costly for us in the long run. And you know what else debt does? Debt ties up resources that God might want you to use for other means. So it keeps you from being able to give graciously, be generous, to see someone who has a need, to give generously to that person who has a need. It is a very binding thing. And I know you all have a heart that says, I want to give more. But I just can't, because I am indebted and I have to pay my bills. So debt ties up resources. And I'm going to tell you something else, is that, and this is based on stats, debt destroys marriages. So listen to this. According to a recent survey, couples fight the most about money and about debt. The survey revealed the following stats for married couples. On the average, couples fight about money at least 3 times a month. The primary reason they fight is over the difference between wants and wishes. Wants and needs. I should say wants and needs. And so 3 times a month, on the average, couples have an argument, raise voices about how they're spending their money and how they're saving and what things they want to have in their life. And, it's an amazing thing, because according to research, nearly 50% of all marriages end up in divorce. And the number one cause of divorce is money stress. So when we get that wrong, there is a price tag that you and I have. And I'm not saying if you're debt-free that your marriage is going to be perfect. What I'm saying is, what would your marriage be like if you eliminated three arguments a month? I mean, that would at least be progress, right? And here's something else that startled me. 30% of adults who are married have engaged in at least one deceitful behavior related to their finances, meaning they did things like they bought something and hid it, that expense, from their partner. That, if you don't see that as wrong, I'm telling you, see me after the services. We're going to do a little death therapy with you. From the movie What About Bob, if you've ever seen that movie, we'll do a little death therapy with you. So money and debt is a huge problem, and Jesus addresses this. In fact, listen to me carefully. Jesus speaks more about money than he does about hell. Did you know that? Speaks more about money than he does about heaven. In fact, he speaks more about money than he speaks about hell and heaven combined. Nearly every parable in the New Testament deals with something that relates to this idea of money. This is a very big thing. So if you're single here today, I don't want to leave you out. So let me talk to you for just a few minutes. Let me just make sure that you hear this as well. You ought to be debt-free as well. You ought to start your life out. You don't want to bring a load of debt. So let's say God brings this perfect partner for you next week. You're single and all of a sudden you didn't expect it. This perfect partner for you. And you don't want to be in a position where that perfect partner has to assume your debt load, right? That just wouldn't be a good thing. So it's, the most vows contain the idea until death do you part. Well, it's not until debt do you part. That's just know that. So no matter what age you are, I'm just saying, start when you're young. Start. Don't wait till you're an old guy like me. I know a lot of people my age that cannot do what they want to do because they're in debt. They can't take the vacations they want to take. They can't retire. They can't do anything because they're in debt. So start young. Start often, start now. So have I convinced you that according to the Bible, that how I handle my money is extremely important? And that debt is living outside of the boundaries of God's will. Have I convinced you of that? Shake your head at me. Don't just stare at me like I'm a wild man up here. So what is the solutions to that? Well, one solution is you continue the way you're living right now. And I promise you one thing, you'll destroy your life. You'll end up shipwrecked, and you're going to end up at the end of your life in a very uncomfortable conversation with the living God. So let's get this part straight in our lives. So how then do I get out of debt? How do I stop living in this credit card debt? How do I do that? Okay, let me give you some practical ideas that are pretty simple, and then I'm going to give you some radical ideas that I think you should hear. So here we go. Here's the first solution. First of all, I think you should repent. I think if you're in debt right now and you have credit card debt that you have gone out and purchased toys or purchased vacations or purchased whatever you're purchasing and you're living beyond your means, that you ought to stop right now and say to God, God, I am wrong. I am wrong with how I'm handling your money. I'm outside of your will, God. I'm not doing what you want me to do with what you put in my hands. So that's the first step. And I just want to say, if you don't do that, then you are not unconditionally surrendered to God. So don't deceive yourself. Don't deceive yourself about this unconditional surrender to God when you are still living the way you want to live and you say, I don't want to hear this, Pastor Dan. I'm saying, listen carefully, this is a big deal to God. It's bigger to God than it is to you. So start with repentance. Because in our life, we just live that way. It's the American way of life, right? We just get a credit card and we just start spending. And pretty soon we find ourselves with this mountain of debt in our life. So stop right now and just say these words in your heart to God. God, I am sorry for living outside of the boundaries of how you've established me to live. You're living beyond your means. And there's a price tag. That's the first practical step. Once you take that step, then there are several other practical steps to take. First of all, you got to deal with your spiritual life. This is a spiritual issue. You're feeding on the wrong thing. So let's talk about what you should be feeding on. So let me ask you a series of questions. Have you been feeding on Jesus' words every day? Do you every day get up somewhere in your life and you feed on the words that Jesus spoke? Feeding on Jesus' words keeps me from feeding in the wrong field. When I'm being filled with Him, I don't need those other things in my life. Question number two is, have I been listening to the voice of God in my life? Am I actually listening to His voice? Am I praying? Am I actually praying over the purchases that I'm making? Have I been away from church? Do I make church a non-priority in my life? Do I make being with God's people a non-priority? Am I in a small group? Am I studying the Bible regularly? Those are questions that when your answer is no to those questions, then you are feeding in the wrong pasture. And when you're feeding in the wrong pasture, you're going to eat the wrong food. And when you eat the wrong food, you're going to get constipated. Caught you there, didn't I? Didn't see that one coming, did you? So I'm just saying, and here's another question. Who are you accountable to for your expenditures? Who is it that you are making yourself accountable to? And if you're in a marriage where you're hiding expenses and hiding things that you're buying, I'm saying you've got a broken marriage right now. And it's only time before it's going to collapse. So start right now with repentance and start feeding on the right things. And then make Jesus your king. Bow at His cross right now and say, I bow before You, and from this day forward, I'm going to make You my king and not a lifestyle. That's idolatry. When I'm living beyond my means, it's idolatry inside of my life. I'm living for the wrong king. I become the king when I'm living for that way. How are we doing so far? All right, so I'm having fun. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Mom. Now, those are the easy steps. Let's talk about the radical steps that we need to take. Here they come. What are the radical steps if I find myself with $16,000 or $8,000 or $30,000 of debt? What do I do? So I'm going to give you three radical steps and then we're going to go home. First radical step is you get rid of all of your credit cards. If you have credit card debt, you are not mature enough to handle that. Get rid of the credit cards, freeze them, cut them up, do whatever you need to do. But if you've got credit card debt, you have a temptation that you can't handle. You're living beyond your means. You're living without self-control in your life. So you've got to take some radical steps. And that radical step is you just cut it up. Now, I'm not saying credit cards are bad. I have three. And Visa pays me $1,000 annually to use their credit card because I use their system. I charge as much as I can. I never pay an interest charge. I pay it off every month because I have money put into an account. And Visa sends me a check nearly for about $1,000 every year, annually, just for using the system. And so credit cards aren't bad. What's bad is my heart. And if I can't control my heart and I don't have self-discipline, then I'm living outside of the boundaries of God's intended will for my life. So get rid of your credit card. Now it's going to get harder. That was the first radical easy step. Now let's take our next radical step, which is a little bit harder. That is, everyone, and I mean everyone, should live in a budget. That's the B word. And people are going, are you stinking kidding me? A budget? And if you've never been in a budget, and I'm just simply saying, I'm trying to help you avoid an awkward conversation with God. When you get to heaven someday, you stand before the living God at the judgment seat of Christ, and Jesus says to you, how did you spend my money? And you go, what was that question? I'm trying to help you avoid an awkward question, an awkward situation with the living God. So live on a budget. If you don't know how to be on a budget, let me put something on the screen here that will help you. This is a tool. We offer financial peace, and you can sign up for it and figure out not only how to live in a budget, but how to do a lot of things in financial peace. And it starts in August, and so you can do that. But I want to address the people that have means. So look at me in the eye. Nobody looking at the floor right now. If you have means, I mean, you've lived life and you've got a lot of money. Here's what I hear a lot of people in that condition telling me: I've never been in a budget. I don't need to be on a budget. And I'm saying, if you're saying that, you're dead, absolutely dead wrong. Because you are making the assumption that your money is yours and not God's. And if it's God's, if I worked in the accounting department at Costco, I would have to account for every penny that's spent and bought. That's called accounting. So I don't care how much money you think you have. I'm telling you, you need to be, everybody needs to be on a budget, whether you have very little or a lot. You need to be on a budget. And if you're not, I'm going to suggest, according to Scripture, not me, according to Scripture, you're living outside of God's intended will for your life. Is the word budget ever seen in the New Testament? Absolutely not. But the word stewardship is. That I'm a steward. I'm a manager of God's money. I'm a manager. I'm not an owner. And a non-budget assumes ownership. That's what an owner can do. If you're an owner, then you don't need to be on a budget. But if you're a manager, you need to give an account for every expense that you have. And if you don't, God is not going to put more in your hands. Smile at me. How are we doing so far? I told you I was going to stretch you a little bit. Third radical step is start giving. Start right now. Wherever you're at, start giving. And the reason I say that is, how many want God's wisdom over their finances in their life? Raise your hand. Well, you forfeit that wisdom when you don't give and live generously and you disobey the commands that God commands you to do. So start giving wherever you're at. And I'm going to address one more thing. And I'm trying to make enemies here today. Because if I don't create crisis for you, you're going to walk out of here and you're going to live your life just as if you never heard what I said. So let me just say one more thing to you. I hear this all the time. I hear people say to me all the time, you know what, Pastor Dan, I give my time instead of my money. And I'm going to say to you, you're still negotiating. You are still negotiating with God. You don't have unconditional surrender in your life. You're just pretending to. You're just telling God how you're going to live your life. And that is not the white flag at all. That is you. That is you doing your thing. And I'm going to say, God's going to let you do your thing right to the very end. But when the end comes, there's going to be lots of missing things for you. So I just pray that you'll hear what I'm saying. I have one more thing to say. Listen to me very carefully. This is really important. And then we're going to sing about it. Listen to me very carefully. Listen to this. Did I say listen? There is no joy in debt. There's none. I've never heard anybody say, woohoo, $16,000 in debt today. Whoa, I'm so joyous. I can't stand myself. It is amazing. I'm going to try to get to 20,000. No, because all that does is create stress, right? That's all it does. But I'm going to tell you what does create joy. You know what creates joy in your life is unconditional surrender to God. That's joy. That's joy. When you give it all to God, when you give it all to God and you just say, God, I am yours. I'm like a sail. I'm going to go wherever you want me to go. When that happens in your life, I'm telling you, when that happens, there is joy unspeakable. Unspeakable joy. No joy in debt, unspeakable joy in unconditional surrender to the living God. So with that in mind, I want you to stand with me. And I want, with your heart, for you to sing this last song.